What's up, Wastelanders? Ryan from War Games News Radio here with another edition of Better Know a Faction, where I break down some special rules and tactics for different factions in Fallout Wasteland Warfare by Modiphius. Today we're going to look at an iconic Fallout faction, and probably one of my favorites in the entire game and in the entire series, the Super Mutants. Now, for those of you who don't already know, Super Mutants are the result of a pre-war experiment called the Forced Evolutionary Virus. Now, this virus has turned them into these giant hulking monstrosities, boosted up their strength, but dumbed down their intelligence for the most part. So let's take a look at the Super Mutant faction special rules, and by request, I'm going to take a look at some different units inside the faction as well, break down their abilities and their stats to give you a better idea of what your force of Super Mutants can do and how you can better terrorize the Wasteland as well as your opponents. Now, much like their video game counterparts, Super Mutants in Fallout Wasteland Warfare are some of the strongest melee units that you can find in the game. Now, it's worth noting that right off the bat, that if you're playing an objective or item heavy base scenario, you're going to want to bring an enslaved tech along for the ride with you. Super Mutants are big old dum-dums, and using an enslaved tech is kind of the only way to get around the fact that only Hammer, Fist, and the Super Mutant Overlord can hack any sort of computer, and their stats are really low to do so. And Fist is the only one of these that can lockpick as well. So the enslaved tech, on the other hand, is good at both of them. So if you're going to need to hack a computer or pick a lock, you're probably going to want to have one of these. Now, mutants don't have the highest armor for the most part, at least in the base units. The standard Super Mutant only has both a physical and an energy armor of 1. But these Super Mutants do have pretty tough HP. Even the basic Super Mutant unit has 6 HP and 6 strength, and it only gets better from there as you go up through the units. Any unit in the game with a strength of 7 or higher automatically gets an extra black die when attacking in melee. So a lot of Super Mutant units, like Brutes and Masters, are going to get this buff due to their high strength without any sort of item mods or any sort of stat boosts at all. Now, this is not a faction-specific rule, but this is just a good thing to remember when the punching starts. The mutants actually have a couple different special rules that make them both very effective when they get up close and personal with the enemy, and increase their survivability and their usefulness of items. First and foremost, super mutants are immune to any and all radiation. So the last thing you're going to want to do is bring a gamma gun to a mutant fight. This makes them nearly invincible when dealing with vermin-like creatures like rad roaches and mole rats. It also means they're going to be able to wade into any areas with radioactive terrain like barrels or special parts of an objective that might deal radiation damage. So important to remember that they're going to stop all that damage just because of the nature that they're already mutated creatures. Now, the next mutant special rule is probably the most important one and isn't quite as passive, but this one applies to fighting in close combat, specifically when using a ranged weapon in close combat. Now, when a unit with the Super Mutant keyword on its card is up close and personal with a ranged weapon, it gets to use its melee attack stat to hit instead of its ranged attack stat. This is a huge bonus because most mutants have a rather low chance to hit with a ranged weapon to begin with. When you use a ranged weapon in close combat, you actually suffer a -2 penalty to your hit roll, and your target's armor goes up by 1. So this super mutant stat switch of using a melee skill rather than the ranged skill when using a ranged weapon in close combat becomes pretty huge. So the higher your Super Mutant's melee skill, the better it's going to be at using a ranged weapon in close combat when it gets a point blank range. Now, just don't forget, you still need to calculate that -2 to hit penalty, and your target gets an increased armor of 1. Now, this rule can also save you some points when putting together your force list because it means you don't necessarily need to equip your mutants with a dedicated melee weapon to make them effective in close combat. Now, I still recommend that you do because it's really going to jack up their chance to hit, but you can use their faction special rule to save you some points if you absolutely have to. The mutants get another special bonus when it comes to food item cards. Most food items have a cooked and uncooked profile on the item card, and the cooked profile can usually only be used if you've taken that item back to your settlement in settlement mode and cooked it up. So if you're out on the battlefield and you ever come across some iguana on a stick or some squirrel bits, to use it right then and there, normally you have to use the uncooked profile of that item. Usually not as good as the cooked profile, and sometimes you get some additional radiation damage and that sort of thing along with it. But if you're a super mutant and have your special faction rules in play, you can use the cooked profile immediately. This is a really cool little thing. I love how the game developers did this to really incorporate the fact that, you know, mutants are these big iron stomach beasts that will eat pretty much anything or anyone that they can get their hands on. And for the last faction special rule, it's not exactly a buff, but it does make a lot of sense lore-wise. Due to their size and general lack of intelligence, mutants cannot wear power armor. In the same vein, super mutants can only equip armor, which specifically says it can be worn by super mutants only. Now, this is fairly intuitive, and while it would be wild to see an overlord strapped into a set of T-51 power armor, that would be highly irregular. And yes, I can already hear some of you saying, "What about Frank Horrigan, Ryan? He's a mutant."
Semper Fi.
Listen. Frank Horrigan does a lot of things, and we're going to talk about Frank Horrigan in our next Better Know a Faction video coming up a little bit later, which we're going to look at the newly released Enclave faction and Enclave special rules. So just hang in there, we'll get around to Frank Horrigan, we'll have Frank Horrigan doing Frank Horrigan things. So now that we've covered the rules, let's take a look at some of the different units in the Super Mutant faction and talk about some of their benefits and pluses and minuses. So we've already looked at the standard mutant, but one of the newer Super Mutant expansions was the introduction of a unit called the Super Mutant Skirmisher. Now, on the surface, these two units look pretty similar. Skirmishers are really cool, though, because they are just a little bit tougher than their standard mutant brethren. They have an extra hit point at 7, whereas the regular super mutant has 6. But more importantly than that, skirmishers have an extra physical armor of 2, meaning that you're more likely to stop more damage more often after taking a hit. There is a bit of a catch with skirmishers, though, as they have some limitations on the types of weapons that they can use. If you notice on the skirmisher card, unlike the regular super mutants, skirmishers are unable to use both rifles and big guns. Now, skirmishers are also a little bit better when it comes to using thrown items. Perception is down by 1 point from the standard super mutant, so not quite as good to hit. Standard Super Mutant is worth 40 points when added to your force list, and the Skirmisher is just a little bit more expensive at 49. Now, speaking of big guns, because big gun attacks are normally calculated on strength, bringing along a missile launcher or a minigun alongside your force is never really a bad idea when it comes to fielding a Super Mutant army. And if you do decide to go big or go home, I'm going to recommend you bring either the Brute or the Overlord unit cards along for the ride to do so. Now, Overlords are one of the toughest super mutant units that you can put in your army, and with a strength of 9, giving them a big gun is going to make them super effective. This means they're only going to miss on a roll of a 10 or a critical fail, so on any roll showing an X. Also, they're resistant to stun attacks, and they actually have 2 aura abilities which are going to buff nearby super mutants as well. The first one allows them to swap a dice when attacking in close combat, so really handy if you want to get an extra yellow dice or something like that to break some armor. And their second rule increases the charge range of any other super mutant units activated on the same turn as the Overlord is activated. Now, there is an exception to this when it comes to dogs and creature units as well. So this is going to make you able to charge much further, much faster, just by having a Overlord on your force and within range of some other units. Now, Brutes are also a great option for big guns, despite being a very melee sort of focused unit. With a strength of 8, they're going to hit damn near everything they aim at, always. Fist unique unit card is, also gets an honorable mention here for the big gun skill because he has a strength of 7, which is also going to make him very effective. But Fist also has a very cool aura ability, which gives any shots not directed at Fisk a -2 if he is within red distance of that attacker. Well, I hope you enjoyed taking a look at some different units in the Super Mutant faction and examining how their special rules can be a bonus to you in playing your games. Now, you'll probably notice that I didn't talk about one of the most unique and awesome units in the game, the Super Mutant Behemoth. I'm actually going to save the Behemoth for another video where I'm going to take a look at some more top tier level monsters and creatures. Deathclaws, Fogcrawlers, Mirelurk Queens, even Mirelurk Hunters as well, and of course, we'll put the Behemoth on that list. That's going to be it for this edition of Better Know a Faction, but stay tuned for the next video when we're going to talk about the Enclave, which is the faction I've been the most excited for a long time now. We're going to take a look at how you can field all those different power armor units to maximize the Enclave special rule as well. Stay tuned. WGNR, we'll be back.